first time, including me. I read it the first time and thought it was a book about racial prejudice. But on subsequent readings, I've begun to realize that it is about so much more. There is so much other prejudice, class prejudice among people of the same skin color. That can be in terms of education, that can be because of economic status. There are lots of ways to create class. Gender prejudice, the narrator of the book is a woman, and she's talking about her childhood, and she was a tomboy, much like the author, Harper Lee, and she winds up with an aunt who is trying to force her into the pink ruffle world, as she calls it. There's religious conflict. There's prejudice against mentally ill individuals, and it goes on and on. These themes are woven throughout the novel. And I've chosen to read a passage that touches on the children's relationship with their housekeeper, Calpurnia. She is African-American. Their mother died when the little girl was 2, the brother was 6. So she has no memory of her mother. And occasionally she'll ask her brother. It's very poignant. But this is a time when their father, who is in the Alabama State Assembly, has gone off to take part in his duties there. And they are home alone with Calpurnia. And Calpurnia has always done a marvelous job with these children. Now he's going to be gone over a Sunday, and this is very important. Oh, let's see. Oh, go on, says the brother. Leave me alone, I'm reading the paper. So Jen got his wish, and I departed for the kitchen. While she was shelling peas, Calpurnia suddenly said, "What am I going to do about y'all Sunday, this church? Church this Sunday?" "Nothing, I reckon. Atticus left us collection." And I should say the children call their father Atticus by his first name. The little girl's name is Jean Louise, but they call her Scout. And she calls him Atticus because her big brother Jim is. Calpurnia's eyes narrowed, and I could tell what was going through her mind. "Cal," I said, "you know we'll behave. We haven't done anything in church in years." Calpurnia evidently remembered a rainy Sunday when we were both fatherless and teacherless. Left to its own devices, the class tied Eunice Ann Simpson to a chair and placed her in the furnace room. We forgot her, trooped upstairs to church, and were listening quietly to the sermon when a dreadful banging ensued from the radiator pipes, persisting until someone investigated and brought forth Eunice Ann saying she didn't want to play Shadrach anymore. Jim Finch said she wouldn't get burnt because she had enough faith, but it was hot down there. "Besides, Cal, this isn't the first time Atticus has left us," I protested. "Yeah, but he makes certain your teacher's going to be there. I didn't hear him say this time. I reckon he forgot it." Calpurnia scratched her head. Suddenly she smiled. "How'd you and Master Jim like to come to my church with me tomorrow?" "Really? How about it?" grinned Calpurnia. If Calpurnia had ever bathed me roughly before, it was nothing compared to her supervision of that Saturday night's routine. She made me soak all over twice, drew fresh water in the tub for each rinse, and she stuck my head in a basin, and she washed it with octagon soap and Castile. She had trusted Jim for years, but that night she invaded his privacy and provoked an outburst. "Can't anybody take a bath in this house without the whole family looking?" Next morning, she began earlier than usual to go over our clothes. When Calpurnia stayed overnight with us, she slept on a folding cot in the kitchen. That morning, it was covered with our Sunday habiliment. She had put so much starch in my dress, it came up like a tent when I sat down. She made me wear a petticoat, and she wrapped a pink sash tightly around my waist. She went over my patent leather shoes with a cold biscuit until she saw her face in it. It's like we were going to Mars. Jim, what's all this for, Cal? I don't want anybody saying I don't look after my children, she said. Mr. Jim, you absolutely cannot wear that tie with that suit. It's green.
Yes.
Suit's blue. What's the matter with that? The suit's blue, can't you tell? Woohoo, I yelled. Jim's colorblind. His face flushed angrily, but Calpurnia said, now you all quit that. You're going to go to First Purchase with smiles on your faces. First Purchase African M.E. Church was in the quarters outside the southern town limits, across the old sawmill tracks. It was an ancient, paint-peeled frame building, the only church in Macon with a steeple and bell, called First Purchase because it was paid for from the first earnings of freed slaves. Negroes worshipped in it on Sundays, and white men gambled in it on weekdays. The churchyard was brick-hard clay, as was the cemetery behind it. If someone died during the dry spell, the body was covered with chunks of ice until rain softened the earth. A few graves in the cemetery were marked with crumbling headstones. Newer ones were outlined with brightly colored glass and broken Coca-Cola bottles. Lightning guarded some graves denoted the dead who rested uneasily. Stumps of burned out candles stood at the heads of infant graves. It was a happy cemetery. The warm, bittersweet smell of clean negro welcomed us as we entered the churchyard. Hearts of love hairdressing mixed with asafoetida, snuff, Hoyt's cologne, Brown's mule, peppermint, and lilac chocolate. When they saw Jim and me with Calpurnia, the men stepped back and took off their hats. The women crossed their arms at their waists, leaped in gestures of respectful attention. They parted and made a small pathway to the church door for us. Calpurnia walked between Jim and me, responding to the kind greetings of her brightly clad neighbors. What you up to, Miss Cal? Said a voice behind us. Calpurnia's hands went to our shoulders, and we stopped and looked around. Standing in the path behind us was a tall Negro woman. Her wig was on one leg, and she rested her elbow on the curve of her hip, pointing at us with an upturned palm. She was bullet-headed, with strange, almond-shaped eyes, a straight nose, and an Indian bow mouth. She seemed 7 feet high. I felt Calpurnia's hand dig into my shoulder. What you want, Lula? She asked in tones I had never heard her use. She spoke quietly, contemptuously. I wants to know why you bringing white chillin' to a nigger church. They's my company, said Calpurnia. Again, I thought her voice strange. She was talking like the rest of them. Yeah, and I reckon you's company at the Finch House during the week. A murmur ran through the crowd. Don't you fret, Calpurnia whispered to me, but the roses on her hat trembled indignantly. When Lula came on the pathway toward us, Calpurnia said, stop right there, nigger. Lula stopped, but she said, you ain't got no business bringing white children here. They got their church, we got ours. It is our church, ain't it, Miss Cal? Calpurnia said, it's the same God, isn't it? Jim said, let's go home, Cal. They don't want us here. I agreed. They did not want us here. I sensed, rather than saw, that we were being advanced upon. They seemed to be drawn closer to us. But when I looked up, at Calpurnia, there was amusement in her eyes. When I looked down that pathway again, Lula was gone. In her place was a mass of colored people. One of them stepped in from the crowd. It was Zeebo, the garbage collector. Mr. Jim, he said, we're mighty glad to have y'all here. Don't pay no attention to Lula. She's contentious because Reverend Sykes threatened to church her. She's a troublemaker from way back. Got fancy ideas and haughty ways. We're mighty glad to have y'all.
Are we ready?
With that, Calpurnia led us to the church door where we were greeted by Reverend Sykes, who led us to the front pew. First purchase was unsealed and unpainted within. Along its walls, unlighted kerosene lamps hung on brass brackets. Pine benches served as pews. Behind the bracket, behind the rough oak pulpit, a faded pink silk banner proclaimed, God is love, the church's only decoration, except a print of Hunt's The Light of the World. There was no sign of piano, organ, hymn books, church programs, the familiar ecclesiastical impedimenta we saw every Sunday. It was dim inside, with a damp coolness slowly dispelled by the gathering congregation. At each seat was a cheap cardboard fan bearing a garish Garden of Gethsemane, courtesy of Tyndall's High Hardware Co. You name it, we sell it. The motto. Calpurnia motioned Jim and me to sit at the end of the row and placed herself between us. She fished in her purse, drew out her handkerchief, and untied the hard wad of change in its corner. She gave a dime to me and a dime to Jim. We got ours, he whispered. You keep it, Calpurnia. Well, you, Calpurnia, said, you're my company. Jim's face showed brief indecision on the ethics of withholding his own dime, but his innate courtesy won, and he shifted his dime to his pocket. I did likewise with no qualms. Cal, I whispered, where are the hymn books? We don't have any, she said. Well, how? Shh, she said. Reverend Sykes was standing behind the pulpit, staring at the congregation. Silence. He was a short, stocky man in a black suit, black tie, white shirt, and gold watch chain that glinted in the light from the frosted windows. He said, brethren and sisters, we are particularly glad to have company with us this morning. Mr. and Miss Fitch, you all know their father. Before I begin, I will read some announcements. Reverend Sykes shuffled some papers, chose one, and held it at arm's length. The Missionary Society meets in the home of Sister Annette Reeves next Tuesday. Bring your sewing. He read from another paper. You all know of Brother Tom Robinson's trouble. He has been a faithful member of First Purchase since he was a boy. The collection, taken up today and for the next three Sundays, will go to Helen, his wife, to help her out at home. Punch Jim, that's Atticus's Shh! I turned to Calpurnia, but was hushed before I opened my mouth. Subdued, I fixed my attention on Reverend Sykes, who seemed to be waiting for me to settle down. Will the music superintendent lead us in the first hymn? Zeebo rose from his pew and walked down the center aisle, stopping in front of us and facing the congregation. He was carrying a battered hymn book. He opened it and said, we'll sing number 273. This was too much for me. How are we going to sing it if there ain't any hymn books? Calpurnia smiled. Hush, baby, she whispered. We'll see in a minute. Zeebo cleared his throat and read in a voice like the rumble of distant artillery. There's a land beyond the river. Miraculously on pitch, 100 voices sang out Zeebo's words. The last syllable, held to a husky hum, was followed by Zeebo saying, that we call the sweet forever. Music swelled again for around us, The last note lingered, and Zeebo met it with the next line. As we only reached that shore by faith's decree, the congregation hesitated. Zeebo repeated the line carefully, and it was sung. At the chorus, Zeebo closed the book, a signal for the congregation to proceed without his help. On the dying notes of Jubilee, Zeebo said, in that far off sweet forever, just beyond the shining river. Line for line, voices followed in simple harmony until the hymn ended in a melancholy murmur. I looked at Jim, who was looking at Zeebo from the corners of his eyes. I didn't believe it either, but we both heard it. Reverend Sykes then called on the Lord to bless the sick and the suffering, a procedure no different from our church practice, except Reverend Sykes directed the deity's attention to several specific cases.